Okay, I guess it's time to get started. Welcome everybody to today's Sustainable Development Seminar Series. As we usually do, we try to pick topics that are timely, that relate to, you know, events that are playing out that have to do with the environment, with sustainable development. And as you have seen from the announcement today, we will talk about the El Niño event that was one of, you know, the biggest that played out over the past month, half year, plus, etc. And you also know that, most of you, I believe, know that when we have El Niño events, the equatorial region of the Pacific is warm, and this can have an impact as much as, you know, raising global temperature. And of course, last year we had another record in the global temperature, surface air temperature. And today we will explore, you know, how all these things hang together and what other effects these ENSO events will have on our environment and society. The seminar will be held as usual. It will be led by Lisa Goddard, who I will introduce in a moment. She has three colleagues who will contribute to the introduction of the topic with short presentations. After that, there is sufficient time for questions and answers. So after introducing Lisa, she will take over, moderate the event, and also introduce her colleagues, Richard, Madeleine, and John. So Lisa is the director of Columbia University's International Research Institute for Climate and Society, formerly known as the IRICP, International Research Institute for Climate Prediction. And the efforts of this particular institute are both in understanding natural variability related to events such as ENSO, but also going out on longer time scales, and importantly, how they relate to our society. Lisa has been working on that topic over the past 10, 20 years. She is not only the director of the IRI, as it is called in shorthand, but also an adjunct associate professor in Columbia's Department of Earth and Environmental Sciences. She is recognized nationally and internationally for her work on El Niño, La Niña, decadal prediction, and near-term climate change. She is leading national and international efforts, such as the Stein Steering Group of the CLIVA, so-called CLIVA program. That's a program dedicated to understanding climate variability and prediction, and that in itself is a program of the WCRP, the World Climate Research Program. So without further ado, I would like to invite Lisa to the podium to give her opening remarks and then introduce the panel.
Thank you, Peter, and thank you everyone for coming today. I hope that we can teach you something, learn something from you, have a lively discussion afterwards. As Peter mentioned, each of us will be giving presentations on the order of 15 minutes or so, and then we'll open it up for questions after that. If you have any immediate questions, say for understanding of what you're being shown, feel free to ask those in the presentation, but let's save the discussion for the end of all the presentations. So I'm going to start off, and then I will introduce all of my colleagues together, and we'll just step through this way. So my presentation is going to be a bit of an overview of this El Niño event itself, and international expectations, and what actually happened, in some cases what was actually done. So let's start out with what actually is El Niño. It's not just the Spanish word for boy. It's not a comedy sketch on Saturday Night Live. Actually, what we're talking about is changes in sea surface temperatures in the equatorial Pacific and how those changes in this big region of the tropics influences the atmospheric circulation, and that leads to changes in regional climate. So let's go way back, maybe a couple centuries. What you're looking at here is a map of the average sea surface temperatures. So we have El Niño, which was named for the Christ child, because in Peru, this actually referred to a seasonal warming of the ocean temperatures right off the coast as the winds would change and they'd blow these warmer waters down off the coast of Peru. And that would change the fish species. This happened every year near Christmas time, hence El Niño. What they also recognized, even just with their coastal observations and personal experience, is that some years, you know, about every 3 to 7 years, that warming would be even stronger off the coast of Peru than usual. And what we've come to realize since we have observations, satellites, boats, measuring temperatures around the world, is that actually these strong warmings off the coast of Peru are associated with warming across the tropical, the equatorial Pacific. Usually we look at that as a difference from the average conditions, which looks something like this. So this would be, say, a typical magnitude of El Niño events, and it's this large-scale change in the ocean temperatures that then affects the atmospheric circulation, as I mentioned before. Now, we know that El Niño and La Niña events have happened for centuries. There are coral records that show it going back thousands and thousands of years. We know that there are periods that are more active, less active, stronger events, weaker events. So this is from our observational record, and what's been highlighted there are some of the stronger events from the recent decades. So until this year, which is a very strong event, until this year, 97-98 was the biggest El Niño event on record, and so it's drawn a lot of comparison with this year. So what does El Niño mean to you? We know it's been happening for a long time, so in some parts of the world it means drought, very severe drought. Those droughts can lead to fires, which then can cause, say, biomass burning, lead to air pollution and air quality issues, can destroy things like telephone and power grids. And that is obviously a devastating impact on the economy, on populations, on the environment. In other parts of the world, El Niño means floods. So parts of the world that might normally appear as a desert turn into effectively oceans. It can be very devastating, say in rivers overflowing and destroying infrastructure, coastal storms leading to severe damage of very expensive property, flooding of local communities that may be low-lying. So in different parts of the world, El Niño means different things. The thing is that over all of these El Niño events, there are some parts of the world that are more regularly impacted in these ways than others. And so now we have these effectively cartoons, these schematics of what are the expectations during an El Niño event. The way that this type of information, I mean, it's been around since the 80s, and I think that the way that this has really advanced in the last few years is with the realization or the communication actually that these expected impacts actually have a seasonality that are associated with them. So it used to be there was a misconception that without the seasons on there, that these were just the impacts. We have an El Niño event, that means flooding in my part of the world. Where's the flood? We must not be having an El Niño. So now what we know, what we've been communicating better, I think, in this event, is that there is a seasonality. And I think that the rest of the community that needs to act on this information is really taking that in, and that's a really important advance. What this doesn't tell you, though, is really how frequently these impacts are experienced. Or, given this particular event, what's the risk of having those impacts? And that's all very important information. So this is this current El Niño event. Very strong, like I said, effectively one of the record events in our observation record. It's been named the Godzilla of El Niños, and that's obviously led to a lot of concern about those impacts, because another misconception of El Niño events is that the stronger event, then we're expecting even stronger impacts. And given that some parts of the world do have very negative impacts associated with El Nino, the fact that we have this Godzilla of an El Nino makes people think, oh my God, worst ever drought, worst ever floods. And so there's really a concern. And so there, it's very important then to bring in quantitatively estimated measures of risk and communication of that risk to the communities that need that so that they can appropriately prepare. Here's an example of the association between the strength of El Nino events and La Nina events and regional impacts. So in India, and I'll explain this graph in just a second, in India, the expectation during an El Nino event is that the monsoon fails, that they have a dry, rainy season. So what the bars are showing you in their deviation from zero is the change that year of the monsoon. So if it's above the bar, that's a wetter than average monsoon. If it's below the bar, that's a drier than average monsoon. And the color of the bar indicates the strength of the El Nino event, which is this magnitude of the El Nino sea temperature anomaly down here. So the redder the bar, the stronger the El Nino event. And you can see that while El Nino events does absolutely enhance the risk of drought, most of these red bars are down here. Not all of them are. And even some of the reddest ones are actually above the bar. So it's not guaranteed that just because you have a strong El Nino event, you will have a strong impact. But the likelihood of that impact definitely does go up. So as I mentioned, there are comparisons, a lot of comparisons that have been made this year between this event and the last very strong El Nino event in 1997-98, showing the peak season of sea temperature anomalies over here on the left. You can see how similar the El Nino itself is in the equatorial Pacific. However, the rest of the global oceans are not the same, and those climate impacts outside of that immediate tropical Pacific region can be influenced by the ocean temperatures in those other tropical ocean basins. All of that is important. What we're looking at on the right then are the rainfall impacts that actually were observed in these seasons, presumably much related to the ocean temperatures. And you can see that while there's similarities, and if you have some of that schematic still in your mind, you'll see similarities to that as well. there are some differences as well. So for example, here's the 1997-98. India is wetter than average. Now this is after the monsoon season, but it continued to be wet, whereas this year it continued to be dry. The Southern African drought was much stronger this year than it was in 97-98. The rainfall over the US is quite different. So there are quite a few similarities, but there are also some important differences. And so actually capitalizing on what you know about this particular event, rather than just El Nino yes or no, can be important to better preparing for the potential impacts. So let's look at what the forecasts actually said. Again, here's what was observed in October through December 2015, and this was what was forecast. So these forecasts are produced by IRI on a regular basis. They go out 6 months. And so this is showing a three-month season. It was made in September. And what you're seeing is not a map of rainfall, but a map of probability down here. So if the probability is favoring the rainfall to be above normal, the more confident that forecast is, the more likely the risk of having above normal rainfall, the more blue it will be. Similarly, for below normal, the more confident that that region will have below normal rainfall, the more brown it is. And so these types of forecasts have allowed humanitarian organizations, disaster risk reduction efforts to better prepare for this event, which is really incredibly new in the community. In fact, right now, the donor community for humanitarian aid is really changing towards what they call forecast-based financing, based on the availability of this type of information and working it through what that actually means for impacts and decisions. So for example, in the Philippines, this is a test country for the World Food Program in their forecast-based financing, and this impending drought really motivated a decision support system that we helped them develop to release funds ahead of that drought to better prepare the communities for those food shortages. At the same time, understanding that even if the season as a whole could be in drought, that region is still prone to getting tropical cyclones. Another region was this probability of wetter than average conditions over the greater Horn of East Africa. This is a place in 1997-98 that had extremely, extremely unusual 5 standard deviation outside the average rainfall in the 97-98 event. They were very concerned about what another strong El Nino could mean to that region. So a specific example that I have of early warning, early action from the Food and Agriculture Organization, this is a UN organization, was some work that they did in Somalia based on the forecasts of El Nino and then the forecasts of the impacted potential climate, as well as the experience in the country of what happened in 1997-98. They estimate that their investment of $1.7 million actually saved about $6.7 million. And there are other organizations that are starting to build up these anecdotal stories that is motivating the donor organizations to shift their focus from response to preparedness. The one thing that I would like to just emphasize here is the importance of the El Nino event. So what are you seeing here? This is 2013. Forecast map looks really blank. Let me go back to. This is this year. Big El Nino forecast map is very colorful. So again, the risk of those impacts is fairly confident in many of these regions. And the reason that you've effectively loaded the climate dice to lead to this confidence is because you have that strong, persistent change in ocean temperatures in the equatorial Pacific that's influencing the climate in this direction. It's not the only thing, but it's a very strong influence. In 2013, same season, the ocean temperatures couldn't have possibly been more normal if you tried. I looked through a lot of years. It's actually anomalous how unanomalous these ocean temperatures are. I'm not showing you the ocean temperatures, but you'll have to take my word for that. But as a result, the forecast didn't have much to go on. Anything could happen. Anything in the range of what's happened in the past could happen that season. But that doesn't mean that there weren't any extreme events that happened. There were some very serious droughts over much of Europe, very damaging flooding in Central America, but we weren't able to give the heads up and the preparedness information on that. So this is a silver lining of El Nino, actually. The fact that we do have negative climate impacts in all years, but the fact that in an El Nino or a La Nina event, those large-scale changes in the ocean temperatures influence the climate means that those impacts are more predictable. So people can better prepare, take better, more decisive actions based on that forecast information. And then looking forward, just a final thought, new research that's been done at IRI suggests that we might actually be able to predict the likelihood in just a sort of yes or no sense, 3 or 4 years in advance. This is several years more than earlier studies on just El Nino prediction itself has indicated. And this is very promising because very often it takes a long time to get these things in place and get people to actually understand what they might do to best prepare. So these long lead forecasts are great potentially for preparedness. And as we're looking forward into climate change and adaptation, it's this preparedness to our current climate and understanding how climate affects us now that incrementally leads us to better adaptation and resilience in the future. So I'm going to stop there. My colleagues, who I will introduce all now, will come up and present their take on connectedness on this El Nino event. We're going to start with Richard Seeger, who is a Palisades Geophysical Institute and Lamont Research Professor. He will talk about the impact on California during this El Nino event. It will be followed by Madeline Thompson, who's a senior research scientist at IRI, and also a senior scholar at the Mailman School for Public Health, as well as a number of other distinctions, which are on your program. So. And then finally, we'll wrap up with David Farnham, who is a graduate research assistant at the Columbia Water Center and has been involved actively in a course that was designed this year, particularly to focus on this El Nino event. So, Richard.
I Okay, thank you very much, Lisa. So Lisa had asked me to talk about the El Nino that is now just ending and how it's had an impact or not in California. So the background to that is that California is now in the fifth year of what since European settlement appears to be a record-breaking drought. The forecast of an El Nino was definitely considered to be good news for California, so we'll see what happened. But first of all, I'm going to talk a bit about the drought. This is just a history of precipitation in California from 1895, when observations begin, up until I think about 2014. And the first thing that you can see here is that there's a tremendous amount of variability in precipitation in California. It all falls in the winter. And that precipitation is both year to year, but multiple runs of years can be quite different from other ones. There was a long drought in the 1920s, for example, and then in the last couple of decades, two or three decades, precipitation has been steadily declining. But you don't see any sort of long-term, century-long timescale tendency to either wetter or drier conditions, just a lot of variability. If you look at histograms of what's happened during this drought for precipitation in individual winters on the top left, the last several winters of this drought, not one of them has been the very driest winter that has ever occurred. But if you look at the four-year average in the bottom there, 2011-15 stands out as the driest four-year average that has occurred since 1895. Temperature is a bit of a different story. 2013-14 and 2014-15 were remarkably warm, and as a four-year average, the 2011-15 is completely off the scale. I mean, it's really hard to even comprehend how variability in climate could give something that is so outside the historical distribution. But there, it happened. So a lot of work that we did tried to understand what the causes of this drought were. And what I've shown there in the top is an average of sea surface temperatures in colors over the ocean during the drought. So this was before the last winter's El Nino, and you tended to have somewhat cool conditions in the tropical Pacific, but warm conditions over there in the West Pacific. The contours there are 200 millibar height, so you can think of that as a measure of pressure in the atmosphere, and you see a big ridge of high pressure stretching from across the North Pacific and across North America. The precipitation anomaly for the United States is in color, so that ridge of high pressure effectively is associated with no storms or very few storms making their way in from the Pacific to the west coast of North America, and hence very dry conditions. So that's what actually happened, and then the bottom is what you get in a series of atmosphere models. So these are the same type of numerical models of the atmosphere that are used for weather forecasting, except they're run to predict, to simulate climate. And this is when those models were forced by the observed history of sea surface temperature. So when the models know about the sea surface temperature, they were capable of recreating the ridge of high pressure across the Pacific and North America, and the dry conditions in California and the West Coast as well. Weaker than observed, but the indication is that some portion of the drought was related to the tropical sea surface temperatures that were occurring. Don't worry about that blob in the north. That's a response to the atmospheric circulation, not driving it. So some part of what happened was related to the sea surface temperatures. And then that persisted through winter 2014-15, where we still had a ridge of high pressure there, dry conditions, still warm waters in the western tropical Pacific. It tried to have an El Nino in 2014-15. It never quite got there, and by January it started going a little bit cooler in the equatorial Eastern Pacific as well. So just quickly about that temperature signal, although I said there was no real long-term trend in precipitation in California, there is a very long-term trend towards warming conditions. So this is coming from the same collection of data, 1895 out to 2015 here, a very striking warming. Presumably some part of that warming is related to rising greenhouse gases. Warming is important for drought because as precipitation obviously reduces the moisture in rivers and soils and so on, when temperature goes up, the atmosphere can hold more moisture and it takes moisture out of the surface. So warm temperatures, reduced precipitation can combine to drive soil moisture down and to drive river flow down. And our colleague, Park Williams at Lamont, did a tremendous amount of modeling of this where he used a model of soil moisture balance in order to work out the contributions to the soil moisture reduction in California during the drought due to both the temperature rise and the precipitation reduction. And when you look at that for the average of all the years here, you find that, 70% of the drought was due to the precipitation reduction, but about 30% or so was due to the warm temperatures. And depending how you say how the temperature rise was contributed to by anthropogenic global warming, or whether it was natural variability, you can come up with various estimates, but potentially between a quarter and two-thirds of that warming was due to human-driven climate change due to warming. So there was some small part of the total effect of the drought that was due to warming. We don't think the precipitation variability was in any way related to climate change. It's just natural variability. So then, having gone through 4 years of that drought then, this El Nino came along. So this is the sea surface temperature that occurred in December through February of the past winter, and this is where we are last week, 4th of May, and you can see the El Nino is now beginning to go away. A little bit of cold water has appeared in the eastern Pacific. So the question then to be addressed was, well, what do we expect this is going to do for California? So this is a series of correlation coefficients for Southern California and Northern California. So winter precipitation by month, by season, so September, October, November, December, January, February, March, and so on. And you can see that the correlation between, and it's a correlation to the sea surface temperature in the tropical Pacific Ocean. You can see that the correlation is much higher in Southern California than in Northern California. And that doesn't get a relationship going until you're in the second half of the winter. So on the basis of this, we were expecting that by the latter part of the past winter, we should start seeing wetter conditions in California and especially within Southern California. The evolution of the El Nino teleconnection during the winter is interesting. So what's plotted here is a composite of a lot of, let's look at the bottom panel here, a composite of all the moderate to strong El Ninos that have occurred over the past century and a bit. So it's the sea surface temperature for the early part of the winter, November through January, and then February through April. That's the color here. And then the contours are again are a measure of atmospheric pressure. So what you see is that as you go from early to late winter, the atmospheric circulation anomaly intensifies over the North Pacific with low pressure here. There's high pressure in the subtropics here that's going to drive winds across the subtropical North Pacific here. And those winds are going to bring storms directly into the southern part of North America, making it very wet. And here's the precipitation anomaly here. And that whole arrangement of circulation and precipitation is much stronger in the late winter than the early winter, despite the fact that the sea surface temperature anomaly actually is getting weaker. And that's simply because the mean sea surface temperature is warming up from late winter to early winter in the tropical Pacific, so the total sea surface temperature is rising. So there's more tropical driving of the atmosphere that occurs. But you've got to realize, however, that this relationship between California precipitation and El Niño is not very strong. If you look at this is just a series of scatter plots, so there's 120-something years here. The sea surface temperature in the tropical Pacific and precipitation in percent, Southern California, Northern California at the top, early winter, late winter. The reds are El Niño events, the blues are La Niña events, and you see that really this relationship is not very strong. So we were never going to have a tremendous amount of confidence that the El Niño was going to be good wet winter for California. On the other hand, when you get to these very strong events, you find that in Southern California, the precipitation anomaly can be truly immense, up to 160% of normal. And even in Northern California, the previous strong events have been wetter than normal. So we really only have two of those, 82, 83, and 97, 98. We knew this El Niño event was going to be as strong as that, well before it came along. And it was therefore very reasonable for us to say, and we did say that, that there would likely be wetter than normal conditions across the state. And potentially it would be wet enough that it would entirely eliminate the drought. But we also cautioned in saying that, that on the other hand, this is not a strong relationship. So that would be couched in terms of probability, not certainty, that that would occur. So in terms of like the forecasting that actually occurred with the numerical models, this is what the forecast on the left for October to December and January to March that the IRI issued ahead of the season. So this was issued in September, this was issued in January. And then I'm just showing here the actual precipitation in millimeters per day, whatever it is. So this is consistent with what we get from the statistical analysis I just showed you, that there wasn't a strong forecast for California of wet in October, December, but by the time you get round to the latter half of the winter, there was a forecast that it would definitely be wetter than normal conditions. This is actual amount, but in terms of probability, it was kind of like 60-70% probability that it would be in the upper third of the historical distribution. This is then what actually happened, and in the first half of the winter it was quite wet across the west coast, but mostly up in Washington state. And then in the latter half of the winter there were some wet conditions centered on Northern California, but Southern California in the latter half of the winter actually became dry. That is not what was expected. So overall, this is the Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's drought monitor maps, which is a combined qualitative and quantitative assessment of soil moisture and hydrological conditions. Before the winter, we had drought across the whole West Coast. Almost all of California was in severe drought. And this is where we were in the map that was issued yesterday morning. So the drought in Oregon and Washington state was entirely eliminated. There was a huge improvement in conditions across much of California, but focused really on the north, not so much in the south. So it wasn't really exactly like we expected, because we expected the major relief to be in the southern part of the state, not the northern part of the state. And we didn't expect much relief in Washington either, but that did not happen, and instead the relief was focused on the more northern parts. So if we compare this with previous big El Niños, these are all winter precipitation anomalies for El Niños of the last few decades, ordered in increasing strength. So this is the most recent one. So this is 82, 83, 97, 98. Huge, these ones had huge increases in precipitation in California, Southern California, Northern Mexico. The previous strong ones had some of this too. And then this one, as a strong El Niño event over Western North America, looks very, very different from what had happened in the previous two. So what went wrong? Nothing went wrong in the tropics. This is precipitation in the tropics for January, February, March of this year. You see the warm waters here were driving increased precipitation above, negative precipitation over Indonesia. And it's this combination of precipitation anomalies in the tropical Pacific that drive the circulation anomalies that should be leading to low pressure over the North Pacific and moving storms into the southern part of North America. All of that in the tropics was exactly as expected. In January, we were very happy. We saw the low pressure, that blue thing, develop over the North Pacific, and everything was looking just like you would expect for a developing strong El Nino teleconnection. And January was indeed very wet in California, including in Southern California. But February then came along, and this pattern got completely disrupted by some kind of middle-latitude wave train that actually placed a ridge of high pressure at the west coast. During this month, all the storms coming across the Pacific started heading up towards Canada and Alaska and not down into the southern part of North America. And then when we went over to March, it started going a little bit back towards a typical El Nino state with a low pressure. And March indeed was wetter in California and Southern California again, and this has persisted into April. But it was much weaker than in January, and you didn't see the normal intensification of the teleconnection going through the winter. I don't think there's really much to say about this other than what happened is some sort of random internal variability in the atmosphere. There was just some weather that came about and interrupted things in February. So a lot of people have brought up the issue of, well, are ENSO teleconnections now not like what they used to be because, for example, climate change? The forecasts I actually showed you that were produced by the IRI only actually use tropical sea surface temperature forecasts in their information. But if you look at the forecasts that were issued by the Climate Prediction Center of NOAA, where they're doing that with an initialized global climate model, they were very consistent with the IRI forecasts. Other forecasts coming from the UK Met Office were also very consistent. Those models know every single part of the state of the atmosphere, ocean, and sea ice system in their initial conditions. So they knew about the sea surface temperatures outside the tropical Pacific. They knew there'd been the warming. They knew about the changes in sea ice. They still predicted wet conditions focused on the southern part of North America, and they were getting that information from this huge El Nino. So I don't think the difference between what happened and what we expected to happen was because there's been some change in the way ENSO operates or the way ENSO influences climate around the world. It's simply that it's not the only player in the game, that there can, this ocean driving of weather has to fight against the internal variability in the atmosphere that is tremendously powerful and can create its own anomalies on monthly, seasonal, and even interannual and longer timescales. And that's what we were seeing that in this location made things depart. And it wasn't still, what happened was not outside the range of what the models say could have happened given the ensemble methods for prediction that are used. But the good news is that there was significant amelioration. California did the right thing in that they did not reduce water restrictions ahead of this event because they were thinking that it would be wet. They realized correctly that it might not be so wet as to alleviate the drought. The water restrictions stayed in place. They lightened up a little bit now because a lot of the reservoirs in the north filled up. But in terms of their adaptation, they did a very good job of dealing with this information and realizing the probabilistic nature of what would happen and continuing to plan for drought stretching into a fifth year, which it has done. Okay, thank you.
Use this time to talk a little bit about the health work that we do at the IRI and its connection to El Nino and some of the differences that we've observed over this current El Nino compared to capabilities that were there previously. One of the key issues for the IRI is that we are a WHO collaborating centre. The World Health Organization has collaborating centers around the world for a whole range of different issues, and we are a collaborating center on early warning systems for malaria and for other climate-sensitive diseases. And this allows us to engage both with the World Health Organization headquarters in Geneva, but also their regional offices here in America is PAHO, in Africa is the African Regional Office, and we haven't to date done much in Asia. The work on health at the IRI engages across the institute, and it's very much trying to. It's very much trying to understand what the climate scientists are able to offer and translate that information into practical tools, practical concepts that the health community may use in delivering improved health outcomes. And that's our priority there. And you might wonder why the health community would be interested. They have a lot of concerns around health outcomes, and there are many, many drivers that relate to that. Poverty issues, for instance, changes in human behavior, urbanization, etc. There are many, many different drivers that impact on our health. But one of the characteristics of climate that makes it really attractive to the health community, or which I would argue should make it attractive to the health community, is the fact that it is systematic information. It is information that has a structure to it, and through that structure, it's climatology, it's diurnal rhythm, it's seasonality, year-to-year predictability, and then on multiple timescales, predictability. And the fact that it is measured routinely all the way around the world by a community that is highly vested in understanding the climate and making that information available. So it's a resource that could be used by the health community, and I would say it's largely underused at the moment, and that's something that we're trying to help with. So I'm going to focus my talk on malaria, but there are other climate-sensitive health outcomes that we could talk about. But we've done a lot of work on malaria in particular through our relationship with WHO. The first thing about understanding climate information and its use is like in our basic research. We need to understand the mechanisms of transmission. All vector-borne diseases like malaria, which depend on an insect to transmit a parasite or a pathogen, have complex life cycles. A lot of the biology of that life cycle is driven in some way by environment and climatic factors. And not only that, the pathogens themselves, being carried by mosquitoes in this example, they respond to climate, particularly to temperature. And the whole of the rate increases in the speed of transmission is very temperature dependent. So we can, you know, use basic climate data and information on the climate to help better understand the drivers of our disease. And then we can use climate information, and this is actually very widely done at the moment, using remote sensing information and GIS tools to help estimate where populations are at risk of particular diseases. If we know that that disease is in some way associated with climate, we can create risk maps that tell us something about the likely geographic risk. We can help also understand the seasonality of disease, and we can look at year-to-year variation, and that's really going to be the topic of our discussion today. We can also help understand some longer-term trends, and the last one is sort of a slightly different way. This is more about how to get the health community involved in climate, and this is, we found, is to be by far the most effective way, and that is the health community has to report, if you like, on the investments that they have made in improving health outcomes. Some of those health outcomes are climate sensitive, and we've argued successfully that if they don't incorporate climate into those impact assessments, then in some way they'll either overestimate or underestimate the value of their interventions. So we know from many studies around the world, just describe one on malaria in Botswana, that we can see responses to sea surface temperatures and El Nino in the case data that we observe. So this is a data set from Botswana. It's a fairly good quality data set for Africa. It goes back to the early 1980s. And here we have taken out the long-term trends, which we know to be associated with drug resistance and other control program issues. And we have looked at the anomalies, and you can see the association of these anomalies with either La Nina or El Nino events. Southern Africa tends to be dry with an El Nino, and what happens in the malaria data is you tend to get less than expected malaria when you have an El Nino. What happens with a La Nina is that you tend to get more than expected malaria when you have a La Nina. And that's a very consistent response there. We've seen also in the highland areas, because of this warming effect associated with El Nino, here you have on this graph, the background is case data from the Carrizo Tea Estates, malaria case data in the workers there. The green line is temperature data, minimum temperature data, and the orange and brown lines are regional warming in land surface temperature and regional sea surface temperature. What you see is that big spike in 1997-98, and that is the obviously associated with that El Nino, and the very, very distinct warming that you got in that region, which was also associated with increases in malaria in the highlands, not only in Kenya, but in other areas as well. Continuing with the 97-98 El Nino, this is what actually happened in a lowland part of Kenya. This is in Wajir, moving towards the Somali-Ethiopian border, have a Somali population, it's a semi-arid region, as you can see on the right. And historically, you have very little malaria reported in those health communities. In fact, the malaria that you do get reported, which is in red, really comes from travellers who've been to a wetter area and have come home, for instance, and carrying the parasites. What happened with the 97-98 El Nino is this massive flooding, huge impact on a wide range of vector-borne diseases, including Rift Valley fever, and a massive malaria epidemic, which killed a very large number of people. And the way in the health community you describe catastrophic death rates is when you get to 10 deaths per 10,000 per day. And the El Nino impact in this region was at that level. So a very, very damaging impact from malaria alone, let alone all of the other impacts that occurred with the El Nino. So you could say, what is different now? You know, what's different about 2015? It's not only that we have better skill in the forecasts and a better communication of that information around the world. We also have many social changes that have occurred in that time and huge investments in infectious disease control in Africa in particular that were associated with the Millennium Development Goals. We also have a massive increase in communication at the local level. The picture on the lower right is a Maasai community in Tanzania who are sitting there, they're chatting on their mobile phones, checking the prices in the local markets, etc. They are now part of the global communication system. And there's massive urbanization. The photograph on the lower left is from Addis Ababa, which I've been visiting consistently probably for the last 20 years or so, and huge urbanization, buildings going up all over the place. Very dramatic changes since 97-98. But the IRI's engagement in trying to think through how we might transform the climate information component to serve Africa's health and other needs really developed out of a meeting in 2005, which was to look at the global climate observing systems program in Africa and see where investments might be made to improve the delivery of climate information across the continent. And here we really found challenges that it didn't really make much difference if you invested in more observing systems. There was no mechanism to get that information to people who actually needed it. There were major gaps in policy, practice, services, and the underlying data. And this has been something that we have been working to bridge really for the last 10 years now, at least. And the way that we have identified to do that is to enhance the national climate services through engagement with the National Met Services and improve at the same time the availability of climate data, the access to that data and the use of that data by decision makers. And the program that we have is called ENACT, Enhancing National Climate Services, with the aim of transforming decision making at the national and local level in Africa. What this is does quite simply is it, by engaging the National Met Services, we're able to access their entire archive of meteorological station data, which is not accessible to the global community, blend this with global products like satellite data or reanalysis data, and then create integrated, high resolution, much higher quality information, which now has both national coverage and local relevance, because the quality of the data is beginning to become useful at the local level. And for health community, that's very important, as I will illustrate later. The advantage fundamentally of ENACT is, on the left-hand side, you have ARC rainfall estimates, use data routinely that is available in the global telecommunication system of WMO, 17 stations for Ethiopia, so that's available to the global community on a daily level. The Met Services in Ethiopia have their own monitoring products now, which use nearly 100 stations. And therefore, the quality of that data is much superior. And if you go into the archive data through the ENACT process, it has access to 500 or 600 stations. So certainly a big transformation in the quality of the data at the local level. And we're able to disseminate this information through the IRI data library tools, which are now in country on the servers of the National Met Services. And this is the type of product that we produce at the moment. On the lower left was basically a product which said, what's the historical impact of El Nino in Tanzania with rainfall? And you can see northern Tanzania tends to get higher than average rainfall. As we would have seen from Lisa's graph earlier on, East Africa tends to be wetter for the October to December season. We can see the change in quality of the data in Tanzania on the left-hand side. This is a regional, national analysis of drought using the weighted anomaly standardized precipitation tool, which is used by climate community for drought analysis. And this is using global products. On the right-hand side, same tool using these national data sets. And one of the things that really stands out is the El Nino of 97-98, and this is because you've got observational data in there. The big challenge that we have with remote sensing data and reanalysis is it tends to reduce the significance of extreme events, which are not well picked up by satellite data. We did this analysis at the request of the Ministry of Health in Ethiopia, who wanted to know how important El Nino was to malaria in the country, and how they should then incorporate an El Nino forecast in their malaria control planning. On the left-hand side, we have the historical relationship of El Nino to the July-September rainfall. And historically, that is a season which is very dry. And the major droughts in Ethiopia are often associated with El Nino in that season. What you have in the center is the high rainfall that is associated with the October to December season. So you have drought in the summer season. The October to December season tends to be wetter in the south of the country. And the right-hand figure is temperature. You tend to have warming across the whole region. So what does that mean for malaria control in Ethiopia? First of all, when we actually looked at what happened this year, they had drought, as we expected, a major drought across the region in July to September, and they also had this unusual rainfall in southern Ethiopia, as predicted. What we see with the historical temperature data is not only these long trends in warming, which we see right across the region now, because we have these new products in a whole Ethiopia, Tanzania, Rwanda, Madagascar, 8 or 9 countries now, is we see these long-term warming trends, but the dark red ones are also the major El Nino years. And this way of putting information together for national decision making is basically a blend then between whatever is the best information in the country with whatever is the best information globally. And working with stakeholders at the national level, that's through the Ministry of Health, and at the global level through the World Health Organization and partner organizations such as Rollback Malaria here, the understanding of climate and its relevance to decision making is beginning to make a significant difference and is beginning to be realized, if you like, as a resource for the health community. So I'd just like to end there and also note that we've had the support of a wide range of organizations in making this type of information relevant and possible. Thank you.
All right, so as Lisa said, I was involved in a class this past semester led by my advisor, Manu Lal, and we were studying El Nino from, you know, the climate science perspective, but also from the management and the impacts perspective. So Lisa was actually one of our guest speakers, and we had a whole series of guest speakers, and then each student researched a specific topic. We were focused on impacts in the U.S. So I was asked today to talk a little bit about the media narratives around this event, and going to, again, stick to the U.S. I should say that I'm not a social scientist. I'm also not a journalist. I'm a hydrologist and an engineer, so this is not a robust analysis of the media narratives, but I did read a lot of articles about El Nino, and so I'm sort of absorbing both the climate science and the New York Times, LA Times perspective on things. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that, and in the context of water management implications. And I'm going to use two anecdotes, one of in Florida and one in Southern California. So I wanted to start off by putting this up here. Richard showed the composite for the U.S. under El Nino, and he also showed a similar plot. But what this is showing here is this is historic El Nino events since 1950, and these are the precipitation responses during the winter time. And again, I'm gonna talk about South Florida and Southern California, so I wanna focus there a little bit. And as we go from the top left to the bottom right, the events get weaker and weaker. And the thing to notice here is, you know, for Florida, there's pretty good consistency that you see high rainfall, but then you have some events where you actually are pretty dry in Florida. The you can't quite see this here, the 87 event. And then also, if you look at California, the 97 event, which is this big one everyone's talking about that was wet in Southern and Northern California, that gets referenced a lot. But then if you look at the 1991 event or the 1965 event, California was actually quite dry. So the purpose of this is just to say that, as Lisa said, we do have increased predictability during an El Nino year, but there's also a lot of variability, and these can be large swings. Richard also showed that with the scatter plots for California. So I'm going to focus on how this uncertainty in response to El Nino is managed in the media and water management sector, but I also wanted to just mention that, you know, it changes depending on what sector you're in. So if you're in disaster relief, Lisa was mentioning, you know, if you have an impending drought somewhere and you think there's going to be a food shortage and you need to mobilize resources, you actually want to have a handle on what the probability of that drought manifesting is. Because if you use a bunch of resources, mobilize food aid, and then the drought does not come to fruition, then you have your donors saying, hey, did you waste this money? And, you know, how did you go about making this decision? In the ag sector, you may buy insurance to limit this risk. And then these last two I'm going to hit here. So we sort of already got to this, but one popular narrative in the media is, hey, this event happened in 1997 and 1998, and the magnitude is similar this year, so here were the impacts then, and here's what to expect. So here's a headline, pretty extreme headline, but these were pretty common. And again, if you look at this Nino 3 SST signal, here what I've done is I've plotted in the blue line the 97, 98 event, and the red line, the current event. So they look pretty similar if you're just focused on the one, the warming in the one box in the equatorial Pacific. But then, as was also pointed out by Richard and Lisa, when you look at the full SST field, these events are actually quite different. And some news outlets did manage to convey this uncertainty and the fact that, you know, these events may not manifest in the same impacts just because their, you know, one-dimensional Niño index was similar. So a few sort of headlines here. Okay, so California and El Niño. What was the media saying before the event? This quote, the mayor of Los Angeles in early November said something to the effect of that there's a 95% certainty that we will see huge impacts, and he was speaking about Southern California. So this sort of seems crazy based on all the maps we've seen, and as best we can tell, this number was actually coming from a NOAA report that said there's a 95% certainty that El Niño will continue through the winter. And so he sort of just said, okay, we're going to get pounded in Southern California. So actually, when this was first picked up by a lot of newspapers, including the LA Weekly, it wasn't sort of discussed as being off. But now in hindsight, in April and in early May, there have been these stories coming out that say, well, the mayor had no idea what was going on, and now in hindsight we say he was actually referencing this El Niño report that was only talking about the sea surface temperatures in the equatorial Pacific, not impacts specific to Los Angeles. A lot of stories on the roofing business in Southern California being a good business to be in this year, leading into El Niño. Everyone was redoing their roofs because they thought they were going to get pounded with rainfall. And then, as Richard mentioned, because the magnitude of this event was large, there were several stories that were saying, well, normally the consistent teleconnection is just to Southern California, but we can anticipate that we'll actually see some intense or some increased rainfall in Northern California, which is actually relevant for the water management story in California, because most of their water is either coming from the Colorado or from snowpack in Northern California and the Sierras. So this is a very sort of low resolution forecast, but this was for January, February, March, just countrywide. And then what I've done here is I've plotted San Diego before this year, January, February, March, precipitation against this Niño 3.4 index. This is the sea surface temperature. And with the red dot, I put the 1997-1998 event. And then I have all the years since 1982. So as you see, as Richard was pointing out, as you get into these extremes, there's somewhat of a consistent feedback, but there are some moderate ENSO events, and again, this is just single station San Diego, where you actually have basically normal precipitation. So how did this year change the game? In San Diego, this blue dot is this year, right? So it really changes the narrative about how consistent this feedback is. And then here on the left, I've plotted the precipitation from October through yesterday, or 2 days ago, for the western U.S. So you see, when you see blue and green, you're above normal. Purple is way above normal. So the Pacific Northwest up here got a lot of extra precipitation. And down here in Southern California, you're actually drier than normal. And then, you know, starting in around April, when the increased rainfall didn't manifest in Southern California, you start getting a lot of headlines like, people, who do we blame? Who do we blame for this El Niño gone wrong, etc.? So as I said, just one other water management implication for California is that what's actually critical is the snowpack in the Sierras and in the Colorado River Basin, because that's where most of the water for Southern California is actually coming from. And one interesting trend that connects to what Richard was showing with this very clear warming trend in California is that the snowpack is actually melting earlier now. So, you know, a lot of water managers think of snowpack as actually sort of a reservoir. So it holds that water, and your system is designed to intake the snow melt based on a certain seasonality, and that seasonality is now changing. So on this plot on the right here, the guy on the left is just the temperature departure from normal for this year. And then on the right, I show the snowpack by basin as of March 31st, so most people think of snowpack on April 1st is sort of the big deal because it's assumed that it snows up till April 1st in the mountains, and then after that it's starting to melt. So that's sort of the benchmark. And most of the basins throughout the West were actually around 100 or 125%. But then as we come to April 21st, compared to normal, they're down around 50%. Some are even less. So the seasonality of the snowmelt is actually changing. Even if the precipitation, you still get enough snowpack during the winter. South Florida, again, there were some sort of a lot of inflammatory headlines about how bad El Nino is going to be. There weren't a lot of positive ones. The other issue in South Florida, or in Florida more generally, is that there's a correspondence between tornado activity. I don't often think of Florida with tornadoes, but tornado activity and El Nino. I'd also like to point out there were a lot of good stories coming out of Florida as well, and by good I mean representing the uncertainty. So citing people who are saying, look, El Nino is setting the stage, we expect wetter than normal, but that doesn't mean the storm's going to track over your locality. So seasonal forecasts, so focused on Florida here. This is October, November, December, and January, February, March. I should note that the winter time is actually the dry season in Florida. So forecasts, basically wet. And I should have also said that the green is indicating that you're above normal and the orange is below normal. So this is not sort of quantitative, it's just which tercile are you in. To step back really quickly and think about one of the main water management issues in Florida and South Florida more generally. So if any of you are planning to drain a giant swamp and develop a bunch of land, you should read about the Everglades in Florida and the history there, and maybe you won't be so keen to do it anymore. So essentially, the lower third of Florida was all swampy land, and around the late 1800s, they tried to drain it and develop, and there's quite a bit of development, as we know now, on the East Coast and on the West Coast. The red here is urban area. But one of the issues is you have this lake here in the middle, and you have an outflow that goes to the Gulf and an outflow that goes to the Atlantic Ocean. And there's a levee on the lake that is in pretty significant disrepair. They're slowly repairing it. So the water levels in this lake you want to keep low. But because of the Migratory Bird Act and several other species protection acts, they actually can't release a lot of the water south because they don't want to flood out the Everglades forest area. And the problem with releasing water to the east and the west is a lot of this water is high in phosphorus because it's run in off of farmland, and so then you create these algal blooms when they hit out into the harbors there, which, there have been some massive fish kills recently. So the management of this lake is pretty complex, and actually it's managed jointly by the South Florida Water Management District and the Army Corps of Engineers that each sort of manage different release points. So it's politically a pretty complex issue. And again, you're balancing this idea of you want to keep the lake levels low, but you also can't release too much water. So when you have increased input into the system, that's a problem, critical time. So what happened this year? In January, South Florida got pounded. So this is with rainfall. This is the percent of normal precipitation in January, and you can't really see these. All of the purple is above 300% of normal. A lot of these basins are 400% plus. And here on the right, I have a plot of this line right here. Can't quite see it. Is the stage of the water in Lake Okeechobee. That's the name of the lake. And so you see through January, this guy's raising way up, and they had to release a lot of water in late January. And interestingly, South Florida's been quite dry since January, but those releases are partially, there have been some massive fish kills this year that are partially blamed on those releases. So, and then moving forward, nobody talked about this yet, but there's anticipation of an enhanced probability of us moving into a La Nina event, and that's associated with increased hurricane activity for Florida. So I'm going to end here, but just to summarize here, each El Niño should be seen as potentially unique. That came through in the, so I read a lot of articles. That came through in the articles post March, April, but before then there was really no discussion of that. I mean, some, but not as much. Obviously, when you're trying to write an interesting story, there's this tension between hyping the event, getting people to read based on a headline, and also discussing the forecasts probabilistically. And then also, there's this idea of, you know, setting the stage. I put up the quote of the state meteorologist from Florida talking about how El Niño sets the stage. But so if you look at Florida here, it's a little bit hard to see, but this is the departure of precipitation from normal from October until yesterday. And South Florida is very green, which means there was a lot of enhanced precipitation. But actually, North Florida was very dry throughout this entire stretch. So a lot of the storms were either tracking over the lower half of the state or tracking up through here. You know, we've read about the intense rainfall in Houston recently, et cetera. So, and because yesterday when I was putting this together, I discovered it was National Limerick Day. I wrote a limerick thinking about Southern California rainfall. So I'll leave you with that.
So thank you very much to our speakers. We're going to move into a discussion part of our event today. And I'm going to sit, I'm not going to stand here. I'll sit with the rest of my colleagues. But we'd really like to invite you, if you have any questions about what you heard, what El Niño is, what it does, what people are doing about it. Maybe you have your own experiences that you'd like to share. So we really just want to open it up and hear what you think and what your questions are.
Hello, thanks for the presentation. My question is addressed to Richard. I was trying to wonder what are the implications of, like when there's this forecast and maybe the insurance sector has to set some premiums for different sectors for a particular year, and then some communities like agricultural producers have to also make decisions based on such forecasts. Do they lose trust maybe in coming years from such forecasts, or like are there any implications to such sectors from when these forecasts don't match what was said and what was expected and what was observed?
I actually don't know the answer. There's possibly some people in the audience who actually know better than me. Is this on?
It's on.
I wonder whether any of my colleagues in the audience know the answer to that. No? Yeah, I mean, the forecast wasn't, over the United States, the forecast wasn't completely bad. And I mean, for agriculture in the United States, the big growing season is in the Corn Belt is in the summer. So, you know, they would be looking at the forecast now for corn wheat yields in the summer. In California, since it's all in, you know, pretty much entirely irrigated, then there've been some anticipation about what crop yields are going to be in California for years now because of the amount of water that's being allocated for irrigation. So farmers there can now expect that they'll probably be given a little bit more water for this coming summer when, you know, there'll be some growing going on. So that would probably be roughly, I mean, but I don't know whether anyone would ever have been confidently thinking that, you know, farmers were going to be getting the same water allocations for this summer as they were before the drought. So they'll be getting a little bit more, but not a lot more. I don't think there's going to be any really negative eventualities out of the fact that the difference between the forecast and what actually happened. I think this summer will be, from what we predict, there should be a higher than normal winter wheat yield. based on some work with, that we're doing right now, because it got a bit wet in much of the wheat growing areas, so the spring soil moisture will be higher than normal, so the wheat yield should go up.
So if I could just add just a little bit to that. I think that for many decision makers, the more sophisticated decision makers, there is a growing awareness of the probabilistic nature of the forecast, so the things that, Richard and I were describing, which is very helpful. It's a big change over the last 20 years since the 97, 98. So for example, some of these forecast-based financing efforts, one of their considerations is how often can they be wrong? They recognize that when you hand them a forecast, that's not exactly what's going to happen. There's a risk that it won't happen. Maybe even the opposite happens. But what's the best way to be prepared? And in 1997, 98, in California, in fact, since the seasonality wasn't quite appreciated, as soon as El Nino was announced, people were expecting the floods in, actually floods in California, which didn't materialize until January, February. And so you started to see news stories in 1997 in December where homeowners were actually suing the National Weather Service because their El Nino rain hadn't come yet, but they'd invested all this money. So I think that even the general population is starting to get it, and the headlines that David showed are a step in the right direction there.
I guess my question then, sort of following up on that for both Lisa and Richard, is when does a forecast fail or when is it wrong? And Richard mentioned internal variability as being part of the explanation for the less than expected rainfall in Southern California. Is that a failure of the forecast, or would you say that that was just an event that was consistent with the probabilistic forecast that was somewhere way out on a tail?
And
just in the context of that, how would you say it was a failure of a forecast, or would you just say
no.
It was...
No, I mean, the beauty of probabilistic forecasting is you're never wrong, right?
Well,
because
there is,
there's
right?
There's like a less than 5% chance that it could have been, you know, catastrophically dry, right? So you can always say, I mean, the work that, you know, we did within the NOAA Drought Task Force, where resimulating the 97-98 El Nino as an analog, showed that there was such a tiny chance of California ending up in the drier tercile of the historical distribution that essentially you could say that's not going to happen. And we did say that in when we issued that forecast in September of last year. And it was unnerving because there was so little probability of the drier third statewide. And that didn't happen. You know, it's like statewide, it's about normal. So I think what actually happened was in the range of what the ensemble forecasting allows. I was at NCAR a few weeks ago, and Clara Dessa had some simulations that she'd done of like 100 member ensembles, that kind of thing, for El Nino events. And you can definitely find El Nino events over that have impacts that look like this over North Pacific, North America, where you have a very weak teleconnection to the North Pacific. And then you find other ones for exactly the same ocean forcing, other ones that have a very strong teleconnection. So I think, you know, I don't think this classifies as a failure.
But we don't want to let probabilistic forecasters totally off the hook, right, as a forecaster. Because you can look at forecast systems, right? So a single forecast is very challenging to say whether it was right or wrong. But you can look at a forecast system over time and see if the probabilities that are being assigned to outcomes are meaningful. When you say something 60% likely to happen, does that happen 60% of the time? So you can test systems to get a sense of whether they're off or not. And there certainly are unreliable forecast systems out there. That's really the responsibility of the climate community, of the forecaster to do that check.
So I guess following on that point, a major El Nino was predicted for last year. Is this forecast system improving over time?
Can I ask the godfather of El Nino prediction to answer that question? I think our models are getting better, but we still have these periods that are more predictable and less predictable, and right now that seems to be our bigger limitation.
Yeah, I think there's just a lot we haven't figured out. And I was going to ask a question along these lines. The climate isn't stationary, and lately, on the timescales that we look at it anyway, there are periods that are, you know, where things seem quite predictable, other periods where they're not so predictable. I noticed that Judah Cohen wrote a letter to, I think, Nature or Science, okay, saying, well, those El Nino guys kind of blew the forecast, I'm paraphrasing, over the U.S., but those of us who paid attention to the Arctic warming and Eurasia got it right. Do you have any comment on that?
Well, I looked at his forecast. I saw that too in Nature. It was just there a few days ago. So then I went back and looked at what he had forecast for this coming winter, and they was talking about, you know, the severe cold in the east, another sort of, you know, polar vortex kind of situation, ridge at the west and trough at the east, and that just didn't happen. So I don't know that he's right, that they did it better. And my point about mentioning, you know, the Climate Prediction Center forecast with the global, the one that NSEP does with the global coupled model, or the UK Met Office ones, where, I mean, they know all the information that Judah Cohen was appealing to in that, and they still had the ENSO response dominating. Yeah. So, I mean, Judah would say they're not getting, you know, the way that the snow cover impacts the stratosphere and so on, right? He would say that. And it's absolutely true that that is not a phenomenon that is realized in current operational prediction models. And he would say therefore the forecast models are wrong, but, you know, many of the at ECMWF or whatever, they would doubt that, right?
Well, I mean, I think that, you know, there is an issue which we won't resolve, but at least it's good to be open to. The natural variability is so great that what you said in essence is not, I'm not arguing with, that the range of possibilities that's given by simply noise, if you want, climate system chaos, encompasses everything that happened and many things that didn't happen, okay? But that doesn't mean that we're not missing systematic effects that are related to things like Arctic warming or, you know, the stratosphere and so on, that would, let's say for this event, have changed the probability distribution of what you would predict.
Yeah, it would have to be something that operational prediction models, you know, do not incorporate within them.
Well, yeah, well, that there's a lot of that.
I'm skeptical of that. That there is such a thing that really is, you know, of sufficient strength that it could compete with ENSO. You know, what I think it, in terms of offering seasonal predictability, I think it's far more likely that what we saw was just some random weather variability that just interrupted the ENSO predictability.
Maybe.
I have a question that I'm really not sure is answerable, but at least I want to kind of pose to the greater audience, and that is, did we learn anything from this monster El Nino, not only from a prediction point of view, which, you know, again, it's a one-time event, and so there's not so much that we could say about whether it's, you know, flawed the prediction, we already talked about that, but also from a public perception point of view, you know, David spoke about you know, how it was viewed differently as the El Nino was building compared to after it had actually occurred, and how the headlines were less sensational and had softened, and it was being treated more in a realistic way. But you know, if you have any thoughts about that, about you know, kind of using it as a case study for whenever our next large El Nino occurs, is there anything that we could speak to as we do with the 97-98 event to kind of better inform us going forward?
I'd just like to pick up that on the public perception issues and the engagement that we've had in Eastern Africa has been interesting because we've engaged across a number of countries which are all impacted by ENSO, but to different degrees. So I showed the example for Ethiopia where really the classic El Nino impact occurred. What was different from previous events and from previous droughts is that the government is very well prepared, relatively speaking. They have drought insurance at the national level, so that was they released insurance funds very early on. But also they have to manage the, or they did manage the information very well. They didn't release El Nino information at the national level until quite late in the process, although the government was already organizing itself and engaged very strongly with the Met Services, and the Met Services, using the new information system they had, were able to show where the likely impacts are going to be and how what they thought were the at-risk issues. For the government, the challenge is that if they release sort of dire warnings of drought for the July to September, then the merchants start hoarding grain, and you actually create a disaster as opposed to alleviate one. So managing that public information is really important. They did then, sort of later, closer to the actual season, then they started talking about the El Nino itself. But Ethiopia has a very managed, if you like, communication within government, etc. If you compare that then to Kenya, where there was a huge amount of Godzilla El Nino in the press, there was a lot of movement of finances in order to manage the potentially catastrophic effects because their experience and their memory is the 97-98 events, which were absolutely catastrophic. And the impacts of the El Nino have not apparently been as severe as they have been in Ethiopia. And the other country that we've been working in is Tanzania. And the Tanzanians, the Met Services were much more cautious about saying that they were going to have a big effect from the El Nino. In fact, they didn't really mention the El Nino that much. They talked about their seasonal forecasts. They felt that they had enough information coming in from the Indian Ocean that it wasn't likely going to be an extreme event. But we have been, we provided information for the region's malaria control and then saw how it was picked up by the different national malaria control programs. And in Tanzania, they were quite proactive because they'd had catastrophic malaria events in the past associated with El Nino, and they started moving drugs up the supply chain early on. And so I had a meeting with them about a month ago, and I said, well, we were still seeing the impact, of course, because they had an extended rainy season, even though it wasn't that severe, and the monitoring of the malaria cases, et cetera, is a bit challenging. So they're still in the process of figuring out exactly what happened. But given that it wasn't apparently so severe, I said, well, was that information useful to you? And they said, oh, extremely useful to us because it got us organized. So I think we shouldn't be talking about whether forecasts are right or wrong and that you can't have a wrong forecast. To me, is it useful is the key thing. And whether the Californian decision makers consider that information useful, I think, should be the criteria whereby you judge the forecast, whether or not it's a blown forecast or not,
If I could just jump in from the management perspective. So the South Florida Water Management, for example, when they do seasonal water supply forecasts, and they look for analogs. So they were using the 97-98, and then they just simulate with some stochastic noise on top of that and say, here's what we're predicting. So there for January, the situation was sort of similar, but as I mentioned, it's been really dry since then. So it's actually, the event has been, it's been very different from the 97-98. So I think that could lead you in two places. One, if what Richard's saying is correct and sort of we're capturing all the dynamics we can, then you just raise the confidence, interval, and you say, hey, we have to prepare for a really wide range of things if we still just use, Nino 3.4 as our way to find the analog years. The other option is maybe there are some dynamics that we're not capturing. There's some subtlety in the warming in the equatorial Pacific that, you know, maybe has consistent feedback someplace in Florida. I'd say with that route, you have to be careful with the sort of Monday morning quarterbacking of looking back and saying, oh, I see this SST compared to 97, and you know, these two cells are much larger, and you know, you could find some spurious relationships that then totally fall apart the next event. But I think the thing to learn is just it's another data point when we have, you know, sort of good, we have pretty good monitoring these days. So we have a data point with high confidence and move forward with that.
So I will say that I think that these sorts of large events, big El Niños, big hurricanes, are learning opportunities. It's a time when public attention turns to that issue, trying to understand it. So I think that there will be things learned from it. Whether or not those lessons learned are still in place in people's brains when the next one hits is another question. My own cynical perception is that the general population is increasingly amnesic, and the press is increasingly dramatic, and so you have these two things coming together. But I do think that some of the big voices out there got taught a bit of a lesson. There's a talking head in Southern California who's responsible for the Godzilla moniker of El Nino. But he got a lot of pats on the back for being really dramatic in the 97-98 event. And, you know, so that worked for him in the past. It didn't work for him this time. I don't know. We'll see if he's learned a lesson the next El Nino event.
I should say the one headline I put up, the five institutions that got it wrong.
He was one of those. Yeah. Picture and everything.
I hear continuously about the lack of recharging of the water table anywhere in the world, and I wondered if California is thinking about redoing their urban planning and such. In other words, turning it into kind of a phoenix in terms of desert ornamentation and such. But my other thing is that is anyone increasing the water table in the world through climate, and is it do we have any hope for the future, or is it just continuous depletion, especially in India, I guess? And so that's my question.
You probably need him. He's the hydrologist.
Yeah, I can't speak too specifically to Southern California's plans for the future. I will say in a lot of areas where we're extracting a lot of groundwater and we have heavy agriculture, I mean, that's the main, especially in California, that's the main draw on the groundwater table. You are having depleting groundwater supplies, but there are also areas where the groundwater table is rising, right? So I guess I can't say much on what their plan is moving forward, but certainly that's something to consider. I mean, in Florida, actually, for example, they inject water into the ground, and a lot of that is to limit the amount of saltwater intrusion from the Atlantic and the Gulf. But
in California, they're moving towards regulating groundwater use, which wasn't being done before. Farmers now have to report the groundwater extractions. So there's no regulatory regime in place yet, but they're getting the data, and I'm sure that they will be moving to regulating surface water and groundwater together. So you're right, it's going down, it's mostly going down within the south rather than the north. But they're sort of beginning to recognize the problem. The big water user in California is agriculture. You know, if you get rid of a cow pasture and put suburban developments on it, the water use goes down, not up.
Yeah, and as Richard just alluded to, I think the person you'd need up here is a water rights lawyer, right? To how that's all going to shake out in California comes down. I mean, people still have water rights based on a piece of paper their great-great-grandfather nailed to a tree next to a river or something. You know, so I mean, there are, you know, and groundwater and surface water is regulated differently. So I think I think they're trying to move that direction, but there's a lot of inertia there.
Really very complicated legal problem.
Speaking of media, I have actually a social media question for Lisa. You put up sort of at the end the slide about that suggests the likelihood of El Nino may be determined 3 to 4 years in advance. And somebody just asked, what points to such a big gain in predictability?
Excuse me?
What points to such a big gain in predictability, like in that new research coming out?
So that research was made possible through these decadal prediction experiments that were part of the last IPCC set of experiments, this so-called CMIP-5. What motivated those decadal predictions in the first place is that there's a lot of decisions being made about climate change and adaptation that really only go out 10 or 20 years, and so there was an interest in actually being able to predict that natural variability. We recognize that can be large. But before those prediction experiments, and again, they're very much experiments, we're still learning how to do it, they're just, El Nino predictions didn't go out that far. I think that there were some stripped down models, a sort of dynamical statistical models of the type that Mark Kane developed that went out maybe 2 years ahead. And there was some suggestion of predictability 18 months, maybe 2 years ahead in those models for particularly large events. So that was very encouraging, but we really just did not have a set of predictions of the past that could look at that question. And so this was the work that we were doing, was to use those experiments and to see where the predictability was in those. And El Nino just happened to pop out as, again, something that has some use, has potentially useful information. It's nowhere near the level of skill that we have for the next 6 to 12 months in current forecast systems, but there looks to be potential there. So now we need to go in and better understand the processes that are leading to that very long lead skill, and how, you know, where the ocean most needs to be initialized in order to harvest that. Well, let me ask a question of one of my colleagues. I'm going to ask for Madeline. Because I know that you were working with the World Health Organization this year in this current event, and they were putting together pretty regular updates on this El Nino situation, what that meant for different countries. I'm just curious, how were organizations like that, how are they actually using these informational pieces?
That's quite difficult. For WHO Geneva, basically they have a global mandate, so they have to support countries all around the world. And it's very challenging for them to be able to provide the right type of information for every country in a short time space. So that's where the collaboration with the IRI is helpful, because it helps them have access to better quality information. But even then, when they provide the information at the national level, it's really very high level information. It's more of a heads up that this is an issue that you should be concerned with, and then maybe a line of possible action items, make a connection with your Met services, get the local knowledge on what's happening, look at your preparedness strategy, identify whether you're in a wet or a dry region, and whether that has particular implications for certain health outcomes that you might prepare for. So those types of documents are really sort of heads up, high level awareness documents. And but what I do definitely see, having been at the IRI since 2002, which is quite a while now, is a transformation in the way the health sector is starting to connect on the climate side, and their search for more practical information. And this is, I think, you know, something that bodes well for the future, because if they only use El Nino type information every few years, to be honest, they're not going to really have much of an impact on outcomes. What they really need to do is have a systematic engagement with climate, understand their climate related risks and how those shift with an ENSO event. So they need to actually be using climate in their routine
decision making, whether it's seasonality or risk mapping or what have you. And that is beginning to happen, I think, in a much more consistent way.
Hmm. And David, with the class, because I think that this is a really interesting thing that Manu did in Colombia to see this event evolving and just very quickly put together a course that could address such a timely thing. I know that the students were taking on projects. Are there, you know, some interesting experiences of maybe the expectations that were set out at the beginning of 2016 as the course was just starting that then became problems in these people's projects? Or how did they deal with those sorts of expectations versus outcomes?
Yeah, so I should say everyone's now submitted a final paper, and we're going to try to pull that into one big paper. So stay tuned for that. In terms of problems for people, I think the big issue was getting data from this year, because it was, you know, these impacts were real time. So everyone was doing a literature review, whether they were looking at ecosystem impacts in a specific area or agriculture response to El Nino in northern Florida, et cetera. They did a literature review and then they could get past data, but getting real-time data and then also getting interviews with the relevant managers or stakeholders was, you know, the more chaotic the situation in the area someone was studying, the less available the people were to give interviews. So I haven't seen everyone's final product, but I know that everyone was pretty successful on getting all the background, but then this year, especially with a lot of these impacts only, you know, coming to bear in the last couple of months here, I think that was one issue, was getting handle on this year. So,
this is an observation more than a question. I'm not a climate person. Very happy to attend today, but I'm really struck by all four of the panelists, I think, making very, very frequent references to the 97-98 conditions. And as somebody who works with data in other fields, at least, it seems to me there's perhaps an over-reliance on a single data point. And the anomalies may not be let me restate it. Perhaps we shouldn't be so disappointed with the predictions that were made for the 2015-16 period if what was really odd were the events that occurred in 97-98 that were somewhat certainly related to the El Nino, but maybe to some other variables that you haven't taken into account, and that all the various data that you found that do seem to be off the charts during that 97-98 period, really not simply the product of El Nino, but those left out variables, and that you would have done a better job even than you have done for 15-16 if you had a better handle on what was left out of the 97-98 analyses or analyses for that period. So that's an observation. You might want to respond to it, and maybe I just have it.
Formed a poor
impression as an outsider, and it's a very superficial one.
No, I think that's an excellent observation. And I think part of the background that we haven't shared with you, the uniqueness of 1997-98 wasn't just its strength, it was its timing in the development of this ability to provide predictions. And again, it was an incredible learning opportunity. There was a lot of focus in this discussion on California, and absolutely California was just, you know, freakishly wet. So was East Africa in the 97-98 event. And in this spectrum of this chaotic weather that could have offset of our expectations could easily have amplified our expectations in that event as well. There were expectations that didn't play out in 1997-98. The Indian monsoon was normal. South Africa didn't experience the droughts they were expecting. Even though they were expecting them, the banks started cutting off loans to farmers. It was a real problem. So each event has these uniquenesses, and I think that's the message that's starting to come out. But in 1997-98, so many things were just getting going that really that event gave an opportunity to predict and to communicate. So for example, the World Meteorological Organization, NOAA, National Weather Service, was a big participant in this, started at that time these regional climate outlook forums where you would get countries and regions of the world to get together and talk about the impending climate in the next season or two. That was a totally new activity. El Nino really facilitated that, and they've been ongoing to today. The National Weather Service really changed the way they did seasonal forecasts. IRI was just coming up. And a lot of other forecast centers were really just sort of cutting their teeth on seasonal predictions. And so it was really a very unique time, I think, in our understanding of El Nino and its impacts and our ability to predict. So that's part of the reason why there's so much focus, and it was just a big event. 1982-83 was also a really big event, and during 97-98, that was the big data point that everybody was pointing to, in particular because we didn't even see that one coming due to the volcanic eruption that had happened recently. So I think that there is a tendency to point back to the last, especially the last big event. As you heard from David, it's actually a very common thing to use those sorts of data points as analogs for good or bad. They're used as analogs. But that's my take on why there's so much comparison with 97-98. If there's anyone else in the room that has a take on why, maybe either through the psychological aspect or the climate prediction aspect.
I'm from Costa Rica, and one of the main problems is to how, when you deal with the press, is how to communicate the uncertainty around a climate forecast. I'm wondering, maybe David, did the press during this major El Nino event in 2015 here in the United States deal with that problem in order to communicate the message to the public? I mean, the message about the uncertainty about the forecast and the uncertainty about the probable impacts here in the United States?
Right, so as I said, I didn't do a quantitative analysis of all the articles written, but I did read a lot of them. And I would say, by and large, most of them did not give probabilities of, you know, here's, you know, forecast for being above, you know, above normal rainfall or below normal, or, you know, extremely above or below. I was sort of disappointed by that, because you do have people using percentages, right? You have the mayor of Los Angeles throwing out the 95. I mean, he used a percentage. It was totally wrong, wrong way to use it. But so I actually didn't see many sort of probabilistic discussions. I mean, essentially how most of the articles would handle the uncertainty is they would say, here's the basic framework. Here's what El Nino is. There was this huge El Nino in 97-98. Here were some impacts, with emphasis on wherever the newspaper was from. And then they would quote a climate scientist, or basically a climate scientist who says, you know, we're not certain that the impacts will play out the same way, et cetera. But usually there was no sort of probabilistic explanation of the uncertainty with regard to the forecasts. Does that answer?
Which is a little odd, because the public has got very used to probabilities in terms of weather forecasts, like 70% chance of rain this afternoon, everyone takes their umbrella, right? And they've got fairly used to probabilities when it comes to hurricane forecasting, track forecasting, and so on. So I think there's been quite an increase in public sophistication about handling probabilities, but I agree. I don't think it was part of the discourse on this particular event in a way that it should have been.
Yeah, and that's why I said I was disappointed, because I don't think that it's above people's heads at all. So it's
no.
Yeah.
I mean, first, just one comment about, you know, 97, 98. It's just to reinforce people. We all kind of look at the last thing, you might say you should weight the entire past somehow evenly, but actually it's not what we do. It's not the way our mental structure is arranged, you know, and perhaps it's better you try to discount the past a little more than sometimes that's maybe not a good idea, but sometimes it is. So I think part of the emphasis on 97 is forced by just the way we are, and meaning the way the media is going to be and the way people are going to be and so on. I wonder, just out of curiosity, if one looked at the media coverage in India, where 97 was a normal monsoon, but 2002, which wasn't a particularly large El Nino, was a very poor monsoon, whether it would have been treated differently, you know? I don't know what they did, but, you know, that would be people with a different sort of experience than most of the world had with El Nino. So it'd be interesting to see how that contrasted. I also had a question, although maybe it's time to quit. I can ask Madeline.
What, one question for you, Mark.
Okay,
we'll wrap
it
up.
Mr. Madeline, it was about, you mentioned what happened in Kenya in 97 and how bad it was, and then that it wasn't so, what did happen this time, or is it too early to?
I think we know something about what's happened, because one of the exercises that we have running at the moment is that the Data Institute here at Columbia is analyzing all of the social media from Eastern Africa which references El Nino. And so one of the things that's very clear for Kenya in particular is that there's an enormous amount of reference around what happened to the budgets that were put aside for El Nino. And that is, I think, the challenge that we have, is at the end of the day, when we ask somebody to make a decision based on information, what we're talking about is a change in resourcing. Somebody's going to shift resources from one direction to another, from one community to another, from somebody's pocket to somebody else's. And that becomes very significant. So if you don't have, you know, you might say from a forecasting perspective, you know, everything's within the same probability distribution. But from an uptake perspective, it really is about where the money goes. And in Kenya, there was a lot of money put aside to deal with potentially catastrophic events, which apparently, as far as we can tell, have not occurred, at least at the level that was expected. And that has raised huge concerns as to whether that money was appropriately used. And what happened, you know, people did do ahead of time. They looked at their culverts for, you know, managing flood water. They looked at their infrastructure, their bridges, and all that sort of stuff to try and be proactive. And at some point, somebody has to make a decision. You know, somebody has to decide invest or don't invest. And the key question to me is, how do you protect those decision makers in uncertainty? Not so much that saying that the forecast is uncertain and therefore every forecast is okay. It's actually the decision-making context is very uncertain, and people have to make really difficult decisions in a complicated environment. And we need to protect those types of decisions, if you like, to enable people to make them in a political sense.
I think that's a great point to end on. I'd like to thank the panel for this morning, and thank you all for coming and your engagement in this discussion.